Welcome to this Snapcast looking at the chemistry of amino acids. Here we see the general structure of the so-called alpha amino acids. We only study alpha amino acids. Common to all amino acids is the fact that they have both an amine group or amino group, NH2, and they have a carboxylic acid group, also known as a carboxyl group. Indeed, this is where amino acids get their name. We take the amino from here and the acid from here, hence amino acids. The word amino acid, or the name amino acids, is intended then to convey correctly that these are molecules that have both an amine, i.e. a basic group, and a carboxylic acid group. What do we call a chemical that has both basic and acidic properties? Coming from the Greek amphi, which means both, they're known as amphoteric compounds. And this will explain later how amines can behave as buffers in our blood. They're also known as two amino acids. The significance of that is that the C of the carboxyl group is two atoms away from the N of the other functional group, the amino group. There are so-called beta amino acids, or three amino acids, and in this particular case, the C of the carboxyl group is three atoms away from the nitrogen of the amino group. So this here is what's known as a beta amino acid, or a three amino acid, if I use the abbreviation AA for amino acid. We will not be considering in our syllabus beta amino acids, but at least you're aware of their presence. There are 20 of these so-called alpha amino acids. In common, they have this carbon, which has got a carboxyl group or carboxylic acid group attached directly to it, a hydrogen directly attached to it, and an NH2 or amino group attached to it. The 20 amino acids differ in what is attached here, and it's known as the R group, or the side chain. Here are some examples of amino acids down the right hand side. For the moment, just look at the top here. We've got glycine. Here's the central carbon in question. Here's the NH2 group. Not sure what this is intended to mean, but if we take the C double bond O, OH here, that's the amino acid, and this is the NH2 group. In the case of glycine, the R group is a hydrogen, so that means that in the case of glycine, the carbon, the so-called alpha carbon, has two hydrogens attached to it. In other cases, that alpha carbon has four different groups attached. So in 19 of the 20 amino acids, we have what's called an asymmetric carbon. It's also known as a chiral carbon, or simply as an optically active carbon. It will have mirror images that are non-superimposable, and therefore exhibit optical isomerism. So, as I've said, all alpha amino acids consist of a molecule where we have a central carbon atom, known as the alpha carbon, to which we have linked an amino acid group, NH2, carboxylic acid group or carboxyl group, COOH. They all have a hydrogen attached to that alpha carbon as well, and they differ only in the so-called R group. In the case of glycine, we saw that the R group is H. In the case of alanine, the R group is CH3. Here are some examples. Again, I'd ask you not to worry at this stage about the fact that the COH group, the carboxyl group, has been presented as COO-, and indeed the NH2 group has been presented as NH3+. This will be explained shortly to you as a result of, it happens as a result of internal transfer of a proton, a hydrogen ion. But for the moment, we'll just consider that to be NH2 and COOH in each case. Keep it simple. And here's examples of other amino acids. Valine. You can see here, there's the alpha carbon. It's got the H, the COOH, the NH2. And then this is the R group in valine. Similarly here, this is the R group in leucine. This is the R group here in isoleucine. The R group in methionine. Notice the presence of sulfur. We'll be talking later when we're looking at proteins at disulfide bonds. Bonds between one amino acid and another, either within the same chain or between different chains. Down here, this is the standard bit of all amino acids, so here we've got this very big R group, which includes the benzene ring, another one in tyrosine, and in tryptophan, even bigger. You're not expected to remember those. We'll look at two or three examples that you should remember. These are too complex. Again, just for the time being, consider these to be the NH2 group, the COOH group, the H group. These are the three groups that are common to all amino acids. So in the case of lysine, this is its particular R group. Arginine, this is the bit that's common to all. So this is the R group in arginine. Again, no one's asking you to memorize these. I'm just letting you see a range of examples of amino acids. And remember, there are 20 of these alpha amino acids in total. Right, let's get down to what we should be learning. And here we see glycine, where the R group is H. And you may see it presented like this, NH2CCOOH, H and R. But you'll just have to get used to seeing these groups in different positions. The COOH group is to the right here, but the amino group is presented at the bottom in this instance. Now in the case of glycine, it has an R group that's hydrogen. Now that means that this central carbon, the alpha carbon, is not chiral, not optically active, not asymmetric, because it does not have four different groups attached. How would we name that chemical with the correct nomenclature? Well, what we do is we have to decide whether we're going to see it principally as a carboxylic acid or as an amine. Well, you cannot name any carboxylic acid without having the COOH group as the first carbon in the chain. So on the basis of that, I'm going to take the longest chain of carbons with the C of the COOH group, the first. So this will be carbon 1, and this will be carbon 2. So if we, as it were, ignore this group for a moment, the NH2 group, what would we call that? Well, if this NH2 group was actually a hydrogen instead of NH2, it would simply be ethanoic acid. But it's got an NH2 group on it, on carbon 2, you notice, and this is the significance of the 2 amino ethanoic acid. So you will need to know the name glycine, the fact that its R group is H, and you'll need to know its proper IUPAC name. Alanine is the next. Again, fairly simple structure since the R group is just CH3. So here we've got the COOH group, we've got the amine group, we've got the hydrogen. That's what's common to all 20 alpha amino acids. And then this is our R group over here. Again, if I was going to name this compound with the correct nomenclature, we would take the longest chain with carbon of the carboxyl group, carbon 1, which would be this chain here, of course. So we would call it propanoic acid. And you see that the amino group, NH2, is on carbon 2, so it's 2 amino propanoic acid. This is another random choice from the 20 amino acids called glutamic acid. This comes up in CA papers occasionally because it's used to make a particularly popular food additive called monosodium glutamate. So glutamic acid, we'll come across its chemistry and how you might make monosodium glutamate from glutamic acid. But let's identify here, there's the alpha carbon with its hydrogen, its carboxyl group, and its NH2 group. So in this particular case, this is the R group I'm circling now. CH2, CH2, COOH. So this is a dicarboxylic acid overall. How would we name this chemical? Let's have a look. Well, if we take the longest chain with the carboxyl group, here's it here. Now, we should name it so that the side group is on the carbon with the lowest number we could possibly assign. So I'm going to number, for that reason, this number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, if we ignore that and pretend that was a hydrogen, that would be called pentane dioic acid. Then we take account of the fact that the amino group is on carbon 2, so 2-amino pentane dioic acid. And this slide, certainly you don't need to be trying to learn this, I'm just putting this up for interest's sake. Some of the amino acids, known as the essential amino acids here, cannot be synthesized from other materials by human metabolism. So these ones on the left, we need to get in the food that we eat. These other amino acids apparently can be made from other chemicals that we would have in the diet. And I mentioned earlier how glutamic acid, an amino acid, can be used to make this important food additive. Look what it does to your food. It's an additive found in many spicy foods in particular. And what you do is you take glutamic acid and you react it in order to form the sodium salt. So if you'd reacted with sodium hydroxide glutamic acid, you would get that typical carboxylic acid reaction with the sodium hydroxide, and that would give you RCOO- Na+ plus H2O. That's just simply an acid and a base giving a salt and water. So this is the salt of glutamic acid. Remember how it was a dicarboxylic acid? 2-amino pentanoic acid. We said earlier that apart from glycine, and this is glycine here where the R group is a hydrogen, 19 of the amino acids have an alpha carbon that has 4 different groups attached. In the case of glycine, it is not optically active. These are superimposable mirror images. Says this is wrong here. The mirror images of glycine are superimposable, that should say. But in the case of the other 19, they are non-superimposable. An interesting point is that for every amino acid, for the other 19 amino acids, there are 2 forms, an L and a D form, standing for lever rotatory and dextra rotatory. We'll look at the roots of that in a moment. But interestingly, only the L amino acids are found as constituents of proteins. Two things to identify when it comes to optical isomerism. It only happens if we have a carbon like here with 4 different groups attached. This carbon has a white, a blue, a red, and a black, 4 different colors attached. Such a carbon is described in one of 3 ways: optically active, chiral, or asymmetric, spelled with 2 M's. Such a carbon will rotate a beam of plain polarized light in one direction or another. The L form will rotate it one way, the D form will rotate it in the opposite direction by the same number of degrees. If you take a look here at this middle image, it's intended to show you that when this is the case, because of the geometry of this molecule, tetrahedral, if you look at its mirror image, And then you consider whether that mirror image would superimpose, in other words, ghost into this. Could you line up the blue with the blue, the red with the red, and so forth? What you find is you might be able to line up the blue, the white, but you'll find the red and the black are the wrong way around, and for that reason they're non-superimposable. Indeed, we'll see in a moment, when you want to present the two optical isomers, what are known as enantiomers, IOMERS, what you simply do is draw one of them and then draw its mirror image, and you can be sure that you have the two different enantiomers. Here we see the person trying to ghost one into the other. You notice the reds are going to work and the whites, but the blue here is clearly in the wrong place or whatever. When it comes to alanine, the alpha carbon there has got four different groups attached, CH3, H, NH2, and COOH. All you need to do is draw your alpha carbon, place the four groups tetrahedrally around that carbon in any position you want, and then simply draw the mirror image of that. This vertical dashed line is intended to represent the mirror, and this is the standard way in which this is done. Now you've got to consider, would one of these ghost into the other? And the answer is no. You imagine bringing this one across to try and ghost it in. The COH groups will line up, the C will line up, the H will line up, but look, the CH3 and the NH2 are the wrong way around. They are non-superimposable mirror images. They're described as optical isomers, or better still, they're described as enantiomers. This slide, presented in three dimensions, may help you to see the fact that these molecules are non-superimposable. These will ghost into one another, so will these, so will the carbons. But you can see that the H and NH3 groups are the wrong way around. These are mirror images, they are non-superimposable, they are optical isomers, or they are enantiomers, and we have a D and an L. This is another slide showing you the same kind of thing. The greens ghost, the reds ghost into one another, the black will ghost into one another, but the blue and yellow are the wrong way around. Optical isomers, enantiomers. This is the instrument that is used to detect whether we have the alpha, have the D or the L enantiomer, or indeed one might have a mixture of enantiomers. And if you have a 50% mixture of the two, since one rotates the beam of plain polarized light in one direction and the other in the opposite direction by the same number of degrees, in a 50-50 mixture of the two, one cancels out the other, and such a mixture will not rotate a beam of plain polarized light and is known as a racemic mixture, though this is not considered on your syllabus, or it's known as a racemate. Let's take a look at what happens here. In simple terms, we use light, but light is made up, as you see, of radiation coming in different planes. What we do is we pass that so-called diffuse light through a fixed polarizer, and it selects out just light in one particular plane, what is known as a beam of plain polarized light. And it's passed into the polarimeter tube here. And in the polarimeter tube, it contains an optically active substance, the D or the L amino acid, for example. And what you can see it does is, in this case, it's rotating it clockwise. It's rotating a little bit clockwise like this. Or in another instance, it might rotate it counterclockwise. And then one observes on a scale how it's affecting that beam of plain polarized light. And you can read on what looks like a protractor the number of degrees the beam of plain polarized light is being rotated, either clockwise or counterclockwise. I'm aware that I'm supposed to be looking this way, so what I describe as clockwise might actually have been counterclockwise when looking from the opposite direction. But hopefully you got the point. Don't worry about any further detail. You will not be tested on the polarimeter. distinguishing between the D and L forms, the two enantiomers. And again, you don't need to know this for A-level purposes, but if you're interested, there is a way in which you can recognize the L configuration by doing the following, by imagining that you are looking down from above on the right-hand structure in the last diagram, it says. And if you read round the other groups in a clockwise direction, you know you've got the L form. If, as you look down, so you imagine you're looking down on the molecule, remember it looks something like this. So if you're looking down from below, looks like a tripod here. Now if you go from the C of the COOH group to the R group to the N representing the NH2, you're spelling out there the CO, then the R, then the N. And apparently in this particular way you have identified, if that's the arrangement, you have the L configuration. And clearly if that's not the way in which it works, if it goes CO to NH2 to R, then you know that you've got the other configuration. So what you're doing in that particular case then is you're setting the molecule down on the desk with the H attached to the alpha carbon up in the air, and you're looking down and seeing, as you go clockwise, in what sequence do you come across the groups, the other three groups. And if you're going from the CO of the carboxyl group to the R of the R group to the N of the amino group, you've got the L enantiomer. But again, this is not required in your A-level syllabus, just for interest's sake. Amino acids are white crystalline solids. That was the only point of trying to put in this picture. But sometimes they're sold, for reasons we'll see in a moment, as chelate metal complexes of the amino acid to make them, because the amino acid acts as a bidentate ligand, and at least as a chelating ligand, and it can make metals more soluble. We'll see an example of that with copper shortly. This is obviously, with its blue color, this is not an amino acid, but a metal chelate of an amino acid. Pure amino acids are white crystalline in appearance. Now, in terms of the structure that we've looked at with an amino acid, we've got the alpha carbon, attached to which we have the carboxyl group. We've got the R group, we've got the NH2 group, and we've got the H group. Now, we can see within that structure the possibility of hydrogen bonding, both with the NHs and with the OHs. Anytime you have attached a H attached to an N, an O, or an F, you can have hydrogen bonding. And of course, water can hydrogen bond. Now, one could explain the solubility of amino acids in water on the basis of hydrogen bonding. But in fact, we'll see that that is not the explanation. There's a better explanation. Now, here we're looking at the fact that there seems to be something anomalous, that amino acids have a surprisingly high melting point, indicating that they have surprisingly strong forces between their molecules in the solid state. Compare the melting point of an amino acid with equivalent molecules, like, for example, this molecule that has only an NH2 group, no carboxyl group. It has a melting point of just 63 degrees C. It's a solid at room temperature, but it melts when gently warmed. Here's a molecule that has no amino group, but it does have a carboxyl group, and it has a melting point of 153 degrees C. Here's a molecule that has both an NH2 group and an OH of an alcohol. This molecule can hydrogen bond both there and there, and yet its melting point is just over half the melting point of alanine, the amino acid. So there has to be more to it than hydrogen bonding. So amino acids are crystalline solids. We're going to find out the explanation for this now as we go through. They have surprisingly high melting points. Now, it's difficult to pin down the melting points, apparently, of amino acids. Why? According to the chem guide site, because they decompose before they melt. So you can't actually get the melting point of the actual amino acid, since it's decomposing into something else before it actually melts. But in general terms, they're considered to melt around 200 to 300 degrees centigrade, most of them. Now, for the size of the molecules we've seen in the earlier slide, this is a high melting point, so something unusual is happening. Let's see what we think it is. If you look again at the general structure of an amino acid here, you'll see that it has both then this basic group and the acidic group. And what actually happens, this is key to understanding the chemistry of amino acids, there is an internal transfer of a hydrogen in the form of a hydrogen ion, what we call a proton in other words. What happens is this hydrogen here comes off. If we look at that C double bond O, OH, let me put in actually the OH bond, it's a pair of electrons shared. What happens is it splits like so, and this comes off as a hydrogen ion. And remember, the nitrogen of the NH2 group has got this non-bonding electron pair here, and that hydrogen comes up here as a hydrogen ion, no electrons, and a dative covalent bond forms between that lone pair and the hydrogen. Of course, the consequence of this nitrogen agreeing to share a pair of electrons is that it's down one electron, in effect, which explains the positive charge that results. The fact that this bond breaks in this manner, with both electrons going on to the oxygen, explains why we have a minus charge here. So we end up with a molecule that has, if molecule is the right word, a molecule or a double ion, a molecule with a double charge, a positive charge there and a negative charge there. And this, taken from the German, zwei means two, this is known as a zwitterion. Now we can see that such a molecule is going to be able to form ionic bonds between the positive parts and the negative parts. And this would be a far better explanation for the melting points, because when you have ions attracting one another, those attractive forces are much stronger than the forces resulting from hydrogen bonding. Just another diagram of the zwitterion. We've got the NH3 plus and the COO minus. Neutral amino acids with hydrogen bonds attract. Now, if we didn't consider the internal transfer of a proton from the COOH to the NH2, we would be looking for hydrogen bonds explaining the links between one molecule and another. And as we've just considered, hydrogen bonds alone cannot explain the relatively high melting points of amino acids. The idea of an internal transfer of a proton and the creation of a zwitterion leading to ionic bonds is a much more satisfactory explanation of the melting point and therefore of the structure of solid amino acids. Of course, some of the R groups might also be charged as well. So, you know, here's your COOH and your NH3+. But here in aspartic acid, because it's got a COOH group as well, there's the possibility that it will ionize too. Similarly here in glutamic acid. And here's an amino acid arginine, which has another two NH2 groups, only one of which is shown here as developing a positive charge. Also it's got a double bond there for some reason, but that's well beyond the remit of our syllabus. Lysine as well, another NH3+. But we don't need any more detail on that. So amino acids exist as zwitterions. Instead of trying to explain their structure in solid form, and therefore their melting points in terms of hydrogen bondings, we instead talk in terms of the zwitterion and attractions between positive and negative ions, which are much stronger attractions and give a more satisfactory explanation of those relatively high melting points, as well as explaining why they appear as crystalline solids and why many of them dissolve in water. These ionic attractions take more energy to break than hydrogen bonds, which explains why amino acids have got higher melting points than we might have expected. Their solubility can be explained along the same lines, again taken from Chem Guide. Amino acids are considered to be generally soluble in water and insoluble in non-polar. If you think of the rule like dissolves like, the fact that they don't dissolve in non-polar and do dissolve, and this is a general rule, some of them will dissolve in non-polar organic substances, particularly those that have got OR groups that are largely non-polar. But in general, the amino acids are insoluble in non-polar and soluble in polar. And applying like dissolves like, we have to conclude that amino acids are polar substances. Indeed, the extreme of polar, which is ionic, and it reflects this vitter ion. In water, instead of looking at hydrogen bonds between the NH2COOH groups in water, we're looking instead at much stronger attractions between positive and negative ions in water with the water dipoles. The extent of solubility in water varies depending on the size of the OR group. So if you've got big OR groups with benzene rings or long aliphatic chains, that's going to increase in terms of, it's going to make it the molecule overall less polar. And that part of the molecule that is non-polar is going to increase the tendency of that particular amino acid to dissolve in non-polar solvents. Now let's take a look at the buffering action. I mentioned at the outset that amino acids with both a basic group, NH2, and an acid group, COOH, it makes them amphoteric. Now, we saw that in the solid state, amino acids exist as this vitter ion, as we see in the middle. This is also the case if we dissolve amino acids in water, or we have them in solution, aqueous solution, which is essentially what we have in your blood. Amino acids would exist in this form as this vitter ion, with the internal transfer of the proton. Now, if you consider adding an acid, when you add an acid, you're effectively adding hydrogen ions. Now, you may recall that a buffer is a solution that can withstand changes to its pH upon the addition of small amounts of acid or alkali. For example, if I was to take a beaker of water, just distilled water, and add using a dropper, just one drop of sodium hydroxide, the pH would swing from around 7 up to maybe something like 10, just in the space of a drop, one drop of 2 molar sodium hydroxide, just in one drop. If I was to add that to a buffer solution, a buffer at pH 7, the change would be slight, might go from something like 7.0 up to 7.2. So the buffer is able to absorb the hydroxide ions from the sodium hydroxide, so the pH changes very, very little. Similarly, with an acid, we take distilled water and we take a drop of 2 molar sulfuric acid, let's say, the pH is going to fall just with one drop, maybe from 7 down to something like 3.5, taking an example, but a big swing with just one drop. If you take a buffer, on the other hand, and you add again a drop of 2 molar sulfuric acid, the pH is going to go from something like 7.0 down to maybe 6.7 or thereabouts, so a very small change in pH by comparison. A buffer then is a solution that can absorb the shock, as it were, of adding H plus if it's an acid, or OH minus if it's an alkali. Let's see how it absorbs the shock. If we add hydrogen ions then here to a solution containing amino acids in this vitter ion, what happens is this group, you'll notice, has changed. It has absorbed the hydrogen ion onto this COO minus. Sorry, you can see it go on there. That's where the hydrogen ion has gone on there. If we add hydroxide ion, what happens is one of these H's comes off as a hydrogen ion, giving us back the NH2, you'll notice here. And that H plus then reacts with that OH minus, mopping it up, forming water. And that's how these amino acids act as buffers in the blood. This is showing it in a similar way. you can see that what's happening here, we've got this vitter ion in the middle here. If it absorbs hydrogen ion plus H plus here, you see that the H goes on to the COO minus. Not sure the significance of this. It's plus OH minus here. And what's happening is the H comes off one of the, where we have NH3, one of the H's comes off to give NH2. As I said, that H plus combines with the alkali that you've added, forming water. Now we need to look at three particular chemical reactions of amino acids, how they react with sodium carbonate, copper sulfate, and nitrous acid, HNO2, not nitric acid. So let's look at these. These are perhaps fairly difficult chemical reactions. First of all, sodium carbonate. Well, an acid will react with a carbonate, a hydrogen carbonate or a carbonate, to form a salt, CO2, and water. So you're going to get a salt, you're going to get CO2, and you're going to get H2O. And the CO2, of course, will come off as a gas and cause bubbling or effervescence. So all that I've done here is just simply build that up, an acid plus a carbonate. Here's our acid, which is the amino acid. In this particular case, part of the molecule is not getting involved. You notice I'm taking 2 moles here. You'll see the reason why in a moment. But it's only the COOH group that's getting involved here, and it's turning to the salt of that carboxylic acid group. CO minus is put in there with the Na plus. The significance of that is that in sodium carbonate we have 2 moles of sodium ions in a mole of sodium carbonate, so the equation needs to be balanced by taking 2 moles of the amino acid. We'll also get CO2 and water produced. I've decided here, as you can see, to show it out in a bit more detail. You might find this of help. Again, the lower part of the molecule is not changing. All that's happening is this H is coming off and the sodium's going on. And because this is times 2, there'll be 2 H's. 2 H pluses. And then there's that CO3 as well. And that combines to give H2CO3 or H2O, and CO2 come out of what I have circled there in blue. The H comes off and is replaced by the sodium. And there's 2 of those, so we get 2 times this. So we're getting the sodium salt of the acid. Remember how we called glycine? Glycine was called, was it 2-aminoethanoic acid? In simple terms, it was COOH. We had a H, and an NH2. 2-aminoethanoic acid, and when it's reacting with the sodium carbonate, just to labour this point to help you, we could write that as CH2, NH2, COOH, just different ways of writing the same thing. These are all ways of representing glycine, the amino acid glycine. What's happening, that's coming off, and you're getting then CH2, NH2, COO minus Na plus. And because there's a 2 in there, we'd have to take 2 of these. We also get CO2 and H2O. Just several different ways of representing the same reaction. Key thing is remembering that an acid reacts with a carbonate to give a salt, CO2, and water, and the amino acid has a carboxylic acid group. Next we'll look at copper sulfate. I came across this in literature on the internet, a recipe for making what is known as copper alanine amino acid chelate. We'll see the significance of this. I'm not going to go into the details of this, but you can see that the reaction mixture is prepared by taking 34 grams of calcium oxide, an alkali, or an alkaline substance, 108 grams of the amino acid alanine, and 700 grams of water. Stirred and left for 15 minutes. And then to that you add copper sulfate pentahydrate. And as the solution was further stirred, apparently a white precipitate of calcium sulfates formed. And you're left with the solution then. And once the reaction was complete, 208 grams of copper alanine amino chelate, having a ligand ratio of about 1 to 1, in other words, a 1 mole of copper ions per mole of alanine. Now we'll see that alanine, which looks like this, C, double bond O, OH, put the NH2 over here in this case, NHH, it's got a lone pair there, it's got the R group and the H group we'll put in there. Now because they have lone pairs, there's a lone pair on that oxygen there, lone pair on the nitrogen, we can have dative covalent bonds form from these groups. So we can have a dative covalent bond form here somewhere and here somewhere. So amino acids like alanine, glycine can behave as what are known as bidentate ligands, bi standing for two. And in this case, what happens, the reason that this is done, is to get the copper into a more soluble compound so that it can enter our bodies, it can be absorbed better in the gut. Why? Well, let's have a look at this advertisement. Here's the claim this company made. Chelated copper, chelated by the amino acid alanine for example, helps this is what copper does first of all, helps to manufacture hemoglobin and facilitates the utilization of oxygen. This is the role of copper, if you can get it into the body in the first place. So it increases your resistance to stress and disease by manufacturing more hemoglobin. Look at the explanation. Copper is an essential trace element found in all body tissues. This mineral is a nutritional partner of iron and is needed in helping you to metabolize or make hemoglobin. Less than 100 grams of copper apparently is found in the body. And maintaining your copper levels, it's claiming, this would be somewhat suspect maybe, but it's claiming that you find it difficult to maintain those levels, and it's saying buy our product because our product helps to chelate copper, change it into a more soluble form that is more easily absorbed in the intestines. So it must be chelated with amino acids. What have we learned? Remember, we want to take a look at this reaction between the amino acid and copper sulfate. So this has been the lead into that to show why this reaction might be of significance. And this is what happens. Very little written on this in the literature. This is what I did come across. That here's your copper, a transition metal which can form metal complexes. And here we see, this here is an amino acid. This will be the C. This is your alpha carbon with the R group, the NH2 group. There's a H missing there, there'll be a H on there, and then it's got this COOH, or in the case of this zwitterion, COO minus. Again, here's your carbon, only the other way around, so there's also a H on here as well. This is your carboxyl group, this is your alpha carbon here at the top in this instance. And because there's a lone pair of electrons on this nitrogen here, like in any NH2 group, and therefore also on here, also on this oxygen, whether it's OH or O minus, there are in fact two or three, two if it's an OH, three if it's an O minus, there are three lone pairs of electrons, and each of these can form a dative covalent bond with a copper ion, which will have empty d orbitals, which will accept the lone pair in the formation of a dative covalent bond. And this is suggesting here the copper with a coordination number of 4, given that two amino acids are coming in, each bidentate, in other words, each forming two dative covalent bonds. And to write a balanced equation for this, what I've done is I've taken 1 mole of copper sulfate and therefore 2 moles of the amino acid. And this is the way in which you could represent such a complex. Within square brackets here, see the square brackets from there to there, we have the structure of the amino acid in round brackets with a 2, along with the copper. The amino acids overall should be neutral. Not sure that it's shown in this particular case. If it was minus, then if there's two of those, that would actually represent a neutral compound and it would have no charge. If it was shown, however, as the normal amino acid, then you would have to leave the 2 plus outside. Okay, I'm going to leave it like that. But the important thing is that in this particular reaction between the amino acid and copper sulfate, we expect to get a metal complex in solution. As to the colour, I'm not sure, but I would liken this to the reaction between ammonia and copper, where we end up with a deep blue coloured solution. We can spend perhaps a couple of minutes just revising some transition metal chemistry and atomic theory here. Copper has this electronic configuration. This is its ground state, 3d10, 4s1. So instead of 4s2, 3d9, remember how it prefers to fill out the d sublevel. Now, what about copper? Where does it lose the two electrons from? Well, it loses one electron in the 4s1 level, and it loses one from the 3d level. So we end up with 3p6, 3d9, and no electrons in the 4s level. Goes on to say here, to bond the four chloride ions as ligands, the empty 4s and 4p orbitals are used in a hybridized form. In other words, the 4s and the 4p merge. So remember, we're not using the 4p either. So here's the, when the 4p, or the, sorry, the, we should say there, the p atomic orbitals in energy level 4, in other words 4p, we've got the 4px, py and pz. What it's saying here is that the 4s, together with the three atomic orbitals in the 4p level, those four merge together to create these four hybrid orbitals. And those are the hybrid orbitals that are accommodating the ligands. So if you think of Cu, for example, NH3, four times, that's where the date of covalent bonds, you can see, are going in there from the nitrogen. Just taking you through a little bit more detail from notes I gave you on atomic theory. This is the ground state electronic configuration of copper, 4s1 3d6, sorry, 4s1 3d10 rather than 4s2 3d9. The copper ion, then, I've explained that we lose the electron from the 4s and one electron from the 3d. You can see what's happening here. The 4s, along with these three atomic orbitals making up the 4p, they merge together or hybridize, forming these four identical hybrid orbitals, and it's those that end up accepting the lone pairs from the ligands. If it was an amino acid, like alanine, remember it's a bidentate ligand, so we'll have a pair of electrons donated in here and in here from one amino acid, and a pair donated in here and in here from the second amino acid. The details of this will not be examined. It's just for interest's sake and for the sake of completion, helping you to understand what's going on. The last reaction then is the reaction with nitrous acid. Remember that nitrous acid, you may have learned from your study of the chemistry of nitrogen, organic nitrogen compounds, nitrous acid is unstable and it's made by the reaction of sodium nitrite and hydrochloric acid. It came up in the study of azo compounds, for example, where we have to change phenylamine to benzene diazonium chloride, and that's where that came up. So nitrous acid is unstable and it's made as shown here. Primary amines react with nitrous acid to form the diazonium ion. or the diazonium salt, and it's highly unstable, degrading into a carbocation that is then capable of reacting with all kinds of nucleophiles in solution and reacting primary amines, and therefore amino acids which have an amine group with nitrous acid, will lead initially to that diazonium salt and then to the carbocation, and then subsequently, even at room temperature, to a whole range of products, alcohols, alkenes and alkyl halides in particular. Let's see some examples of that. First of all, let's leave amino acids and look at the simple case where we have an amine, like ethylamine, also known as ethylamine. We reacted with nitrous acid produced in situ by the reaction of sodium nitrite and hydrochloric acid. And look at this particular arrangement here. This is key for this diazonium ion. It's got that N triple bond N with a positive charge on here. And because this is an ethyl group, it's known as ethyl diazonium chloride. You may liken that to something you studied in aromatic chemistry, where we had this ion, positive charge on here, and Cl minus. That was known as benzene diazonium chloride, where we had to keep that at a temperature below 5 degrees centigrade, although the syllabus seemed to go for below 10 degrees centigrade. So this would have to be kept cold, otherwise it will decompose and create, this will turn into a carbocation, which in this case would be CH3CH2 with a positive charge on that carbon. And that's a highly reactive intermediate, and that will react with, for example, sodium bromide solution and form CH3CH2Br. It would react with water and go to CH3CH2OH and so on. When it comes to organic synthesis, it's great to be able to make chemicals that are very reactive. It enables the process. Now, here's taking this through to this carbocation, as I've described, because this is you form this is unstable, it produces this along with nitrogen, and then, as you can see here, reacted with water, you get ethanol, reacted with a chloride solution, you get a halogenoalkane, a chloroalkane, in this case, chloroethane. Not sure about what you use here, what the conditions are to produce the alkene, but there's another possibility. Again, if you want to see it done out now for the amino acids, we've learnt to apply it for the amines. Well, we do basically the same. The lower part of the amino acid doesn't get involved. It's just the amine group. You see this isn't changing down here. So what happens is this changes into this diazonium ion, and then it's going to form this will be the equivalent of the carbocation here. This is your alpha carbon, is going to have a positive charge along with nitrogen, and then of course if you react that with, let's say, sodium chloride solution, you're going to get a chlorine on there together with the HH and COH. Or if you reacted with simply water, you're going to get an OH group on there. So you're going to end up with, for example, if the chlorine goes on, you're going to end up with CH2 with a Cl on there and a COOH group. If you reacted with water, you're going to get a dicarboxylic acid. You're going to get CH2 with a COOH group at this end and a COOH group at this end. That would be propane dioic acid in that particular case, if alanine was the amino acid chosen. So I've taken this through here to give you some examples. There's your carbocation reacted with sodium chloride. You're going to get that. Warm it with water, you're going to get an alcohol. How did I get that carboxylic acid to maybe got a little bit carried away there. This here I should have had as an OH group, so I didn't. I'm sorry about that, I've made a mistake there. That should have been OH there, so it's shown correctly here. It was not a COOH, but an OH that was going on when it reacted with water. So it's not a dicarboxylic acid at all, but it's a molecule that has both an alcohol group and a carboxyl group. And here's one example then right the way through. We've taken here alanine. We've got the nitrous acid, which is made in situ. And we're showing it here because water, this would be in solution, given that this is, we've reacted sodium nitrite with dilute acid. There would naturally be water present. And here you see what we're getting. We're getting this particular molecule here, together with water and nitrogen produced. And that ends our look at amino acids. And if you're ready, you should then move on to take a look at the Snapcast dealing with proteins, which is really about how these amino acids come together to form polypeptide chains as a result of condensation polymerization. We'll see that proteins consist of polypeptides, which are essentially polyimides. They contain the link C double bond O and H, making them polyimides. And we'll be looking at their primary, secondary, tertiary structure, and briefly looking at their so-called quaternary structure as well. So thanks for listening.